This is the story of a group of ordinary men who undertook an extraordinary musical journey.
I mean, to be seen walking down Dublin with a fiddle on your arm or a set of pipes, and your friends would give you a terrible slagging. It was slightly embarrassing, so you'd do a sort of a different way of getting there.
These men not only helped to re-energize their native music, but also spread that music throughout the world.
I heard a very prominent radio personality calling it Diddly Oi music one time. Diddly Oi music, he called it. Yeah. He got his Diddly Oi after it, I can tell you.
Starting off, we didn't know quite where we were going until we got there.
This is our music. This is, you know, if I wanted it to be, this is my music.
The music has gone from strength to strength. And there are more young people playing traditional music now than there ever were.
For over 45 years, the Chieftains have been traditional music's biggest band and have attracted the admiration of some of the world's biggest stars.
You know, they've been rocking and still are, you know, for longer than we have. It's something.
Why are they important? Well, because of the work they've done.
They represent to most people in the world what Irish music is and its possibilities. And that's a huge achievement.
The Chieftains are the people who actually put Irish music on the map. They did the touring when nobody else was doing it.
The Irish thing is like high octane, so amazing to listen to.
They are the kings of traditional Irish music. It's hard to quantify how important they are.
They brought Irish music back to the forefront.
This is the story of the Chieftains and their remarkable, though sometimes rocky, journey to the top.
People ask how we're still together after all these years, and we probably all have the same answer. It's because we stay apart.
On the road, we kind of go our own ways, different parts of the plane.
Hotel rooms, we stay on different floors.
Eat at different times.
We know more about one another than we'd like to know. We just don't have sex.
And how one man's vision and determination created a global phenomenon.
I just love the music and I see the music. I see it before I ever play it or write it down or whatever. It's out there, it's like an image. And to me, it's part of my whole life. It's part of having to have food. If you have food or something like that, I've got to have music. I think it's an essential part of my life. I could never live without it. I'd love to bring this show with me throughout the world, just tour it, you know, as it is. I think it'd be smashing, you know. Something about this waterfront theatre, it just has that loveliness about it, and in the round like that, you know, makes you feel there. It's a party that's going on, you know, not a concert.
These are the Chieftains, arriving in Belfast for their latest sellout concert. A chieftain is the leader of a tribe or clan, a fitting name for a band that's had at least 10 members since it began. But the chief of the Chieftains has always been Paddy Maloney.
Paul, we usually have a small wiser here for the Bowron. As a child, this music was bred into me. It was part of me, and I knew that was going to be part of my whole life. To me, it's what I am and what I've known for so many years and just love to do.
When you dip your toe into a tradition as deep as Irish music, there's a huge universe of experience there.
Mihal, you're going to have to get used to that.
Yeah. It is. I mean, there always has a certain amount of joy. Listen to the Chieftains. I always felt a certain sort of lift, yeah, up, an upness.
Unlike today, up until the 1950s, traditional Irish music was a specialist interest and not widely listened to.
I remember growing up and going down to my grandparents and in this little cottage in County Leash, and they'd play a few tunes and then up they'd get and start to dance. Then my mother bought me a tin whistle when I was six, seven, I think, something like that. But I had this natural gift of being able to harmonize something. If I, you know what I mean? I couldn't sit still by playing the melody. I'd have to be doing something with it.
For me to be playing Tin Whistle with Paddy Maloney, it's like he picks it up and goes, oh, here's something like this. And it's just, it's like part of his hands, it's like part of him.
I've never heard anybody express on any instrument any more eloquently or more evocatively than Paddy Maloney.
Growing up in the North Dublin suburb of Donnycarney, Paddy showed a natural talent for music.
I was very fortunate where we were born. There was five pipers in that area. It was kind of a triangle of Ilian pipers. And the man who made my first set of pipes, Leo Rowson, he was called the King of the Pipers.
With the King of the Pipers as his mentor, Paddy was soon being entered into piping competitions all over Ireland.
I only got second, I think, for the first one. And my God, I said, next year, that's not going to be the story. Eventually, afterwards, won four All-Ireland medals. I mean, I took 2 days off after off school afterwards to celebrate. But Leo Rowson, I always remember, he got me up on his shoulder and marched me down the centre with all the crowd, you know, and I said, oh, this is for me now, this is showbiz.
With a taste for show business and a talent for music, Paddy spent his youth experimenting with different bands and instruments, searching for the sound he was looking for. Eventually, he would find a group of fellow musicians with similar ideas to his own.
Years would be a very, very small number of people in the cities anyway,
yeah,
who would know anything about traditional music, and it'd be kind of ridiculed, you know, in certain places, you know, yeah. People would laugh at the idea.
We only had the Pipers Club on Thomas Street in those days, in the mid-late 40s, and then the Church Street in the mid-50s.
We were just all there as musicians, and we just all got to know one another.
As the 50s became the 60s, traditional music was beginning to make a real comeback. Contributing greatly to this reawakening was the pioneering Irish composer, Sean O'Riordan.
When I first met Sean was around 1960, 61. He was very flamboyant and, oh gosh, you know, you to know him, you know, his personality and everything was so colourful.
I wear a hat as a traditional musician in the Irish tradition, but also because I've been trained in a European background, I compose European music, 12-note music, serial music.
What was different about him is that by the time he hit his 20s in the 1960s, he started to experiment with traditional music and traditional musicians themselves.
He started to talk about some ideas that he had, and he liked what I'd been doing, and we actually start to write out tunes. And it went on then for a couple of weeks. We used to meet up, and he said, you know, I want to put a group together. And I said, great, that's terrific.
He formed a group called Cultori Cúlan. That's obviously Irish language term. It's difficult to spell and difficult to speak, so people forget it, and they don't really know it that well.
Paddy had already been playing regularly with Sean Potts and Michael Tupperty, and in Cultori Cúlan, they were to join forces with fiddle player Martin Fay.
My first meeting with the fellas was in Sean O'Riordan's house. I was playing with Sean in another field altogether, and he mentioned he was starting a folk group, as he called it.
O'Riordan put traditional musicians on stage in a different kind of group. It was a concert group. You didn't dance to it. That was radical. I mean, that was postmodern. O'Riordan never took the music internationally. He died too young. The Chieftains were the ones to take it out. They were the ones to take it off the island.
Though regularly playing with Cultori Cúlan, Paddy wanted to concentrate on his own group. A chance meeting with an aristocrat who shared his passion for traditional music would change everything.
We weren't one of the tribes of Galway. So music was all around me in a way, and I was very aware of it, but not consciously.
Well, now, Gareth, the Honourable Gareth Brown, and one of the great Guinness heirs, but a very colourful and quite a brilliant lad in a way. And I remember meeting him in 1956.
I had heard Paddy Maloney playing, and I was absolutely riveted by it. And I was deeply impressed, and I never looked back.
In 1959, Gareth created a record label called Clatter Records.
Irish music had been so starved, they were really welcome to have anybody with a different view or background.
The label had a simple aim: to preserve traditional Irish music and art, a task made easier by the circles Gareth moved in.
We just used all our friends, and some of them were writers, and some of them were singers, and some of them were actors, and some of them were poets, and some of them were drunks, and some of them were not.
And eventually, in 1962, I had hit on the sound I wanted, like with Sean Potts, Martin Fay on the fiddle, and Michael Tuberty on flute, and myself on pipes and whistle as well.
And so I sat down with Paddy and said, let's form a small group of musicians, and it could only be what appeared to be genuine traditional instruments.
I remember Paddy saying, we should do a record. You know, he was always on about that, you know, about doing a record.
In 1962, with the addition of David Fallon on Byron and calling themselves the Chieftains, the group met to record an album.
But we actually recorded the whole album in 5 evenings, you know, because we all had jobs. We all had our daily jobs. And so from 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock, we put down the Chieftains 1.
The cover featured contemporary artwork by Edward Delaney, unusual for the time.
The covers look rather different than a cow in a field chewing its cud in front of a piano with the rest of the band sitting in the field, so that it made the person who'd actually had the good manners to pick a record up think.
The group may have had a record out, but for the next 5 years, these ordinary men were under no illusions.
There was no way you could go and earn a living as a full-time musician, as a full-time traditional Irish musician.
I worked for an electrical engineering place. The amount of time I could take off work was very limited.
I was a transport inspector with the post office, so there were only 3 of us working the whole country, you see, so it was rather difficult.
I was working as a civil engineer, and the job that was involved was the passenger terminal at Dublin Airport.
Paddy Maloney was working in a shop called Baxendale's. It was a good, secure job.
I started off as an office boy there and pushing a pen, you know, great hopes of becoming an accountant.
I was running a record company single-handed, and it was beginning to work and need somebody full-time.
And they offered me the job then as to go full-time with Clatter Records. And it was a bit nerve-wracking because I was pulling up the stakes and leaving a pensionable job. But I was, you know, in there as managing director right from the beginning and got to know all of the production of sleeves and marketing and recording. And, you know, there was 3 albums there when I started, and there was 45 when I left.
While running Clatter, Paddy also took the Chieftains back into the studio to record another album, this time with Pather Mercier on the Byron.
And I have a pet theory that that man, when he left the womb, really left the only paradise on earth. And that in that paradise, the sound, the music, was the heartbeat of the mother. And I like to think that the Byron is that sound, that extraordinary, primitive, elemental beat.
Thank you. The second album also introduced Sean Keane to the group, a young fiddle player with a unique style and flair.
I first met Paddy 50 years ago. He was only a lad, but Paddy and I played a few, I remember a few times playing with him for his sister to dance.
You know, I've known him since he was in short trousers, and he came along with his brother to the Piper's Club in Thomas Street, and one could only see brilliance.
Sean had been discovered by Sean O'Riordan and asked to play in Kiltory Coolin.
The story is that O'Riordan met Sean Keane, and O'Riordan came back and said, "I have met a fiddler," he said, "who plays like an angel and looks like a Greek god." And that's pretty accurate. And I know Sean knows that story well, I'm sure, you know, and probably hates it. But he does look like a Greek god, and he certainly plays like an angel.
The Chieftains added to their momentum with the addition of another new member, perhaps the most unusual chieftain of them all.
In 1972, I met old Ding Dong Bell, Derek, which was great, you know, playing with the BBC Orchestra in Belfast. He was the harper.
He was in the Royal College of Music when I was there, and he wrote a symphony every week. I mean, he was a complete madman. And we had to play the stuff, too, in the orchestra.
When we first met Derek, he had an old pullover on, and there was a big hole in the front of it here. And the sole of his shoe wasn't attached, like it was, yeah, was flapping there. So, God, we said, you know,
he's not odd socks,
odd socks, had he?
You know, you could just mistake him for a charming eccentric if you didn't hear him play.
Good evening. Tonight I'm going to play you a little concert on many widely contrasted instruments. And since I learned the piano to begin with, I think I'll start with a piano piece, the Grande Valse Brillante No. 1 in E flat by Chopin.
His capabilities, his talent, his artistry, and his genius were boundless.
You know, I remember Derek going to his superiors in BBC and being told, "Derek, you know, I have great time for you, but I don't have any time for that Paddy Maloney fella. You know, what are you doing with a tatty folk group like that, you know?" This is what Derek had to put up with.
Well, I'm afraid we have to bring this little concert to a conclusion. And what better way than with some Irish traditional music played by the Chieftains? Oh dear, I'm afraid the Chieftains aren't here tonight. I have to deputise for them. I think they've gone off for buns and tea.
He famously made a record, or infamously made a record, for Clatter Records, which people laugh about still, where he's pictured on the cover, surrounded by the many instruments that he played, harpsichords, harps and cimbalums and various woodwind instruments, and the title of the album is actually Derek Bell Plays With Himself.
My memories of him were an absolutely fun person, but eccentric. We were very welcomed by all of them, but us girls particularly were very welcomed by Derek. But I remember what he said to me, which was, when we came into the room, he goes, "Come into my arms and let me feel your exquisite vibrations."
And in finding Derek Bell, it did introduce a splash of colour to the Chieftains that had never been in traditional music before.
The new lineup recorded their fourth album, which featured a track called Women of Ireland. It came to the attention of movie director Stanley Kubrick.
And a phone call came through during one of the press conferences. "Hello, my name is Stanley Kubrick, and I'm doing a film here."
And Paddy actually couldn't quite remember who he was. It was an unexpected call, and he wasn't quite sure if he should take it.
"Would you be interested in doing some of the music for it?" And I said, "Oh, Mr. Kubrick, that sounds great, but just at the moment I'm in the middle of a very serious press conference for the release." "Oh, I see. So could you pick up again with me and maybe phone me back on Monday?" You know, which he did.
Kubrick originally only wanted one tune for the movie, but Paddy, not only a musician but an astute businessman, saw an opportunity.
I went over to visit Stanley in England and went to his house, and I had a tin whistle, as I usually do, in my inside pocket, and pulled it out, and I played him a few tunes. And I mean, he only wanted 5 minutes, but at the end of the evening, I'd sold him 25 minutes of Chieftain's music.
The film went on to receive 4 Academy Awards, including one for Best Music Score featuring the Chieftains.
It would have been, I guess, 1975 when Melody Maker went totally overboard on the Chieftains. Suddenly, they were getting front pages, and at the end of the year, Melody Maker made them Band of the Year, you know, against all these progressive rock bands and all this. And this bunch of Irish musicians were the Band of the Year. I think the readers, they're really confused, didn't know what was going on.
But it wasn't just the music press that had been following the Chieftains.
There were various people who had approached us about taking us on as managers, and we were all, I suppose, kind of wondering, would it be worthwhile?
Yes.
And we kind of resisted it until Joe Lustig came along.
Joe was a high-powered, you know, manager from the Bronx in New York.
He always had this little dog with him, you know, wherever he went, he carried the dog. He'd be always in his arm like this, you know, it looked very strange.
And he was a heavy, heavy manager. I mean, I was terrified of him, and he used to bark at you, and he had to, "Hey, Ty, hey, Ty!" Of course, so in Britain, we'd never seen anything like it, you know, especially not on the folk scene. Everything was very kind of amateurish and done on a kind of a wink and a promise.
Joe Lustig hated Irish music. He couldn't stand it.
Then he came to me with this crazy idea. "You won't believe it, you won't believe it. I got you a gig at the Albert Hall." There was silence, you know, and I said, "God, oh, Joe, would you ever get down off the stage?"
Joe thought he would impress them by making a grand gesture, and he booked the Royal Albert Hall.
I couldn't believe he would come up with this crazy idea. I said, "The whole 6,000 people, you know, we're playing to 500 or 600, you know." So I didn't think we were ready for it at that time, you know. But he said, "No, I promise you." I said, "Well, look, Joe, if you fail, that's the end, you're gone."
And Paddy said, "Well, if you can sell out the Albert Hall, OK, we'll sign with you. You can be our manager."
And in 3 weeks, he sold it out, and I couldn't believe it.
We didn't realise how big it was until we got there.
That was a very emotional concert. I talk about it even to this very day.
And to see that crowd going around that theatre, you know, at the end of the evening, dancing around.
You know, I almost started crying. Yeah. You know, it was very hard to keep playing.
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was very,
got
very
that
emotional.
Too. I got that feeling as well, Mick.
And Potts and myself with tears in our eyes, arms around us, you know, we actually sobbed, you know, we made it, you know what I mean? So that was the kickstart for us to go full-time professional and chuck in the job, you know.
The landmark gig meant the calls started to come thick and fast.
Tonight's Whistle Test features the new Zeppelin album, but first of all, a group I'm delighted to welcome to the programme, the Chieftains. Their success recently has been very impressive. They've had tremendous media support. The Melody Maker in particular has championed them for some time. Meanwhile, Hewlett is the title of the opening number, the first one tonight from the Chieftains.
With a triumphant Albert Hall gig behind them and a string of TV appearances, big decisions had to be made.
There was murmuring in the background of going professional, and we didn't want to listen to it, but in hindsight, we must have known in our heart of hearts that it was going to happen.
And Lustig kept after us. I remember him phoning me in work. "How much are you getting?" he said to me. "How much do you earn a year?" So I stuck about $4,000 on top of my wages, you know. "I'll treble it."
I came in from work one evening, actually. Mary picked up the paper. She said, "Sean, is this right?" And on a Chieftains Go professional.
I got 3 months' leave of absence in October 75. Leave of absence. I never went back.
"Well, look, if I'll give it a try for 6 months, you know, long 6 months."
Chieftains went professional in a world where classical musicians were professional, where rock and pop musicians were professional, but traditional musicians weren't.
And you're in for an hour of some of the best music on the planet. Would you welcome the Chieftains?
As well as going professional, the Chieftains left Clatter Records.
We couldn't just be tied to Clatter's apron strings. It wasn't going to happen record-wise. It had to move on.
But that was inevitable because we weren't big enough to handle them. And the object, as I said, was for the musicians themselves to benefit.
It had to be done the way I did it, you know. Otherwise, we would never be here. We wouldn't be here today talking.
Having split with Clatter, the next few years of being managed by Joe Lustig would be far from easy.
Even a couple of months after we had signed with him, he was up in arms looking for something that I didn't think he should be part of. And like my publishing, you know, I never signed away my publishing.
I remember him saying that Paddy Maloney was unmanageable, which makes me laugh because, yeah, I can see that. You know, Paddy was essentially the manager. And would take him on, would have no qualms about taking Joe on if he didn't agree with him.
I was still watching, you know, this big percentage going out to this high-powered manager who, as far as I'm concerned, did a good job. I had no qualms about that, you know. He deserved, you know, what it was, but not forever, you know. He just lasted 2 years.
As the band went full-time, Byron player Pather Mercier retired and was replaced by Kevin Conniff.
The Byron has an immediate appeal for just about everybody, you know, and the same instrument is found in most cultures in the world as some kind of a drum like that. And I remember when I was three or four, I remember getting from Santa Claus a tin drum and drove the whole family nuts, you know, until somebody hid it.
I heard him playing the Byron. I was very impressed with his style, very precise, very unique, you know, and just, I thought, perfect for the Chieftains.
Kevin was also to bring with him a collection of traditional songs which Paddy started to incorporate into the Chieftains' act.
"If I had a wife, the plague of me life, I tell you what I would do. I'd buy her a boat and put her afloat and paddle me own canoe. If I had a wife, the plague of me life, I tell you what I would do. I'd buy her a boat and put her afloat and paddle me own canoe."
To be honest, initially when I was involved in traditional music as a younger fella, the Byron was a secondary thing to me, you know. I enjoyed singing and collecting ballads more than anything.
It added a new colour and a new style and new everything to the band, and it was all building like that, you know, from the 76, 77 onwards is when he joined.
Becoming full-time musicians should have been great news, but the pressures from relentless touring were beginning to tear the group apart.
You kind of got the sort of whiff of rumours that you know, people weren't happy in the band.
I had been trying to leave for about a year and a half.
It wasn't the lifestyle that they had envisaged or even wanted.
Yeah, you know, you have to be martyrs. You have to have that vocation.
The actual travel and being away from home just didn't suit me mentally.
At this stage, I still could go back to the job, you know.
The whole travel aspect and the living in hotels, which initially I thought was really exciting, but that wears off very quickly. I realised that the enjoyable part of the day was the period on stage.
I just didn't like playing on stage. I didn't, you know, okay, we got an awful lot of praise and adulation and all that, but I never got used to that. And, you know, I wanted to be at home.
To me, I thought it was going to break up somehow or other. And should I leave as well, or what's the point? I was already, what, 4 years in the group. Out of four years was gone. I had no job to go back to, so it was make your mind up time.
Well, you know, when they came to me just before Christmas, I saw the whole bottom fall out of the Chiefs. And
it almost looked like by the end of the 70s they were going to fall apart and that was it.
With the release of their eighth album, An Era Past, original Chieftains Michael Tubridy and Sean Potts returned to their day jobs.
It was hard on Paddy, I know it was a difficult time for him, but he's a great soldier. Like, he didn't say, well, I'd pack up now or anything like that. He went on, and then he got Matt in. Just couldn't. In fact, I think they got better.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Chieftains.
I think the genius of Paddy was getting Matt Malloy involved, because Matt Malloy was such a respected flute player.
I was very lucky to get Matt Malloy. He was the last, the baby, the band, you might say.
People looked and knew, well, if they're good enough for Matt, because, you know, the man is probably Ireland's greatest flute player.
The first time I met Matt was in a pub in Dublin, and in the intermission I went over and said to him, my name's James Galway. I play the flute in the Berlin Philharmonic. And he said, oh, yeah. Big deal.
When I was growing up, my father played, my uncle played, and my grandfather, whom I never met, he also played. And they all played flutes. Don't ask me why. At that time, there was never any thought of working professionally. I mean, it just wasn't there. So you played for the love of it, and I still play for the love of it, too.
Matt had been a founding member of the Bothy Band, whose unique take on traditional music enjoyed phenomenal success in the second half of the 1970s.
We were sort of putting rock rhythms into the hardcore traditional music. That's what we were doing with the Bothy Band. And that's why it appealed to a younger audience who were listening to heavy-duty rock and roll.
I remember a friend of mine, and she said, I think he's the sexiest flute player I've ever heard. He's probably that, but he's just an incredible musician.
During my spell with the Bothy Band, I contracted tuberculosis due to the lifestyle, really. I wasn't behaving. I was making an ass of myself, and so I decided that I'd definitely sort my situation out.
So it's been that way ever since, and it's been that's the combination that we've had, you know.
After joining the Chieftains, Matt and the group played their biggest gig ever.
I was only in the band 3 or 4 months, whatever it was, and we were asked to play in the park when the Pope arrived. You're going to see 1.25 million people just spread out into the distance.
The whole occasion was very emotionally charged, of course.
Well, it wasn't just our gig. It was the man in white that drew the crowd, not us.
With a solid lineup, the Chieftains were to spend the 1980s exporting their unique sound to every corner of the world. They started with America.
Because we were first of our kind to do this sort of thing in America, so it built up huge interest amongst right across the board, not just Irish or Irish-Americans. Everybody, our audiences, have continued even to this day.
A lot of American music
has borrowed or has actually been inspired or is the core of it is a lot of Irish music.
The Chieftains were the first non-American group to play in the United States Capitol building and would often tour the country during the decade.
I remember one day doing 28 interviews in the one day, press interviews, television, radio, all that sort of stuff.
They later collaborated with legends like Chet Atkins and Ricky Skaggs on the Grammy-winning album Another Country, which featured one of their most famous tracks, Cotton Eyed Joe.
I suppose that was the start of our American country music odyssey.
I mean, Nashville would be nowhere without the Irish. Yeah. It's the melodies, the harmonies, and certain ways of playing.
You find the Chieftains beginning to penetrate and intersect other sonic cultures, other musical cultures, and doing it in a very natural way.
The headline of the decade was when the Chieftains became one of the first Western groups to play in China. But it only happened after Paddy spelt out conditions to the communists.
I was, you know, quite open with them. I want to film it, I want to record it, and I want to bring some guests.
Invariably, it was Paddy got these brainwaves, you know.
Most of the people wore the Mao uniform with the little caps and the red star on them.
At that time, as you know, China was a pretty closed shop.
They were the first Western band to play on the Great Wall.
We got up on one of these turrets, you know, the little castles, and we filmed and recorded.
Of course, nobody spoke English, and we didn't speak any Chinese. And it was mayhem. But it was fun. I mean, you had to keep your sense of humour, you go mad.
The group also started to experiment with their live performances. Michael Flatley, who would later star in Riverdance, joined them on stage. And a collaboration with classical flute player James Galway was particularly successful.
I'd convinced Paddy to stop making these Chieftains 15 and 16 things and do one with me.
James Galway, I can't believe it.
What am I doing here? I asked myself. I was flying from New York to Ireland, and the flight was delayed for about 2 hours. So they put us in the lounge there, and who was in the lounge? Paddy and the boys. So we got going in there, and when we got on the plane, we were well away.
The Chieftains and James Galway recorded an album together, which featured arrangements of well-known Irish music.
It was strange for him to be sitting in with a traditional band, you know, it's a little unusual.
I tried my best to fit in with the guys, and you see, we're all entirely different trained. I'm trained as a classical musician, but I can play the tin whistle like a classical flute player. But these guys, they play the tin whistle like Irish pipers and like tin whistle players with all the little things, you know. And every time I go back now, if I learn one of these little tricks, they say to me, Jimmy, you're sounding more like a Catholic every day. Yes. Gentlemen, you'll have to excuse us. We have to go and lubricate a few flutes.
On Raglan Road, on an autumn day, I saw her first and knew that her dark hair would weave a snare of that I might one day rue.
The Chieftains also collaborated with Van Morrison on the album Irish Heartbeat, taking a unique approach to some well-known Irish songs.
I get this phone call and, hello, this is Van, you know, as if I wouldn't know. And he said, it'd be great to get together, some lunch and that. So we met up and I thought I was going to have this, you know, huge lunch and wine and all that. So we went to a sort of a fish and chip place downtown. One of his favourite joints, and you know. We had eggs and beans, and I said, God, this guy is dead on, you know. I got really liked him after that.
His wings at the dawn of the day.
They've always had that thing that people from the rock world just adored them.
Collaborating with other artists was to take the Chieftains right through the 1990s. You never knew who they may join forces with. Even Frank Zappa was a fan.
I tell you what would be very nice, Frank, if the Bowerons started and they were to start a drone, and Matt came in on the flute. How about that?
In the mid-90s, having written music for films such as Far and Away, Rob Roy and Braveheart, the Chieftains decided to try something very different. The band risked everything with the release of a record called The Long Black Veil.
When I got the first copy of The Long Black Veil back here to listen to, I suppose it was about to be released, and I put it on and listened to it, and I listened to it again. And I walked up the lane out here, and I started kicking at stone, saying, what the hell are we at?
The Long Black Veil is a pop album. Essentially, it's a pop album.
It struck me that the whole thing had strayed from what the Chieftains initially were all about, which was promoting traditional music.
So this is a total harebrained idea, Paddy's.
I don't just go out and say, oh, God, I must have a song with him.
And in 1994, I got a call at home from him, and he said he wanted me to sing a Gaelic song.
Well, how sting, you know. I know it's an Irish, but, you know, I'll get translation into English for McGillamar, you know.
So I said, look, I don't really have much time. Can you come to my house in England and bring the band and record it in my studio?
And that was on a Thursday, and on Tuesday we were in his house in the south of England.
We started off with lunch in my house, and now everybody got a little bit drunk, surprisingly. And Derek Bell, the lovely Derek Bell, fell in my river up to his knees. Well, he didn't change. He wouldn't change throughout the session. He sat there squelching through the whole thing. I think experiments like that are always useful. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't, but it's worth the risk.
It's amazing what happens when you do put people into a studio.
I was drag screaming into some of them. You know, I didn't really think that maybe this isn't that appropriate. But I went anyway, and we did some of this stuff, and some of them worked very well.
The Long Black Veil featured some of the world's biggest stars of the time, including Sinead O'Connor and guitarist Ry Cooder.
She was totally full of emotion, and I guided her the way I put that effects on it, and Ry Cooder was there also. So I had some lovely backing from Ry.
Most people think a recording studio is scientific, dry, dull, and so you don't always do your most dynamic, but not Paddy. And I've had great times with him in the studio, and he can put this little turbocharger he's got in himself through the instrument at any time.
But when Sinead was finished, you know, and I'd gone through and got all that passion out of her for that last verse, and particularly she just sunk to the floor in tears. It was so emotional, I'll never forget it.
Very, very heightened sense of the dramatic. It's what he knows how to do, and he can, by God, flat do it.
In the merry month of May, from me home I started, left the girls aflame, sad and broken hearted, saluted father dear and kissed me darling.
But perhaps the most remarkable collaboration was with the Rolling Stones.
It was just kind of a meeting of bands, you know, a bunch of troubadours.
7 o'clock, the boys arrived in a bus. I didn't think they were coming, and brought their entourage and their own bar with them.
They came in to the studio well armed with plastic bags with drink of all sorts in them. And
we were all sober, cranked on strict orders not to even think about a drink until we got this out of the way.
Doing the track was in between having fun, I mean, as I suppose it's supposed to be. We at the Stones are fascinated by, you know, the different styles of playing.
Keith Richards, it took him quite a while to get the hang of the 9/8 rhythm, you know, the slip jig.
But I think Paddy wanted to throw in the satisfaction bit.
Keith was saying, how did you get that satisfaction? I mean, who told you to put that in the middle? I said, oh, I just dreamt this idea up myself. I thought, just to keep in touch. Oh, yeah, okay, yeah. Oh, yeah. The stays of cigarettes were flying.
But it was just a joy to play with such different contexts. You know, I just felt I'd been transported. And, you know, where? I don't know. I'm not back yet.
The Chieftains had risked everything with the Long Black Veil, but the experiment proved both popular and lucrative.
So the Long Black Veil actually worked as bringing more people into the world of traditional music. That was a great surprise, and built the extension on this house.
The Chieftains followed their experiment in pop by returning to their traditional roots, though still unafraid of trying new things.
Over the last 15 years, we've concentrated a lot on bringing young people and giving them an opportunity, like the likes of Carlos Nunez, the Galician Piper. You might say he was the seventh Chieftain when we made Santiago, because he's on every track, and he's a wonderful genius of a musician, great piper.
I like the Santiago album, the Galician album. Another album that I enjoyed doing was the Breton album.
Celtic Wedding and Santiago were both, retrospectively, much more influential than people imagined at the time.
The music was fairly close to our own. It was easy for me personally to settle into it anyway.
They kind of created the groundwork where Celtic music was... did become kind of universally popular.
I mean, they can play everything from like tribal, Gaelic, Celtic music to that very, very sophisticated sort of 19th century. And the way Irish music evolved, it's all there in that one band.
1, 2, 3, 4.
In fact, the Chieftains have continued to experiment with traditional music and with a variety of artists.
I know my love by his way of walking, and I know my love by his way of talking, and I know my love dressed in a suit of blue, and if my love leaves me, what will I do?
Paddy had an idea of the song that we would do together, and so sent us a tape of it, and... It frightened us a little bit, to be honest, because it was like, I know my love. It was like this old voice of this woman. And beautiful as it was, what? To us, we were like, what? But obviously, Paddy had his ideas of how this was going to be.
Well, don't you think that vexes me? And still she cried, I love him the
joys are few. And if my love leaves me, what will I do? We were right to trust that Paddy knew what he was doing with this song, so, and he did. But it was a little daunting initially.
To date, the Chieftains have released over 40 albums and won 6 Grammy Awards.
Given every ocean and ship is a throne, and for each mast cut down.
Their latest Grammy came in 1998 for their soundtrack to The Long Journey Home, a documentary about the Irish in America, which featured Elvis Costello.
That I'm bound to find a better life than I left behind.
It was supposed to be a national anthem for the Irish exiled in America, or those that had come. That was the way Paddy put it to me, that it needed to have the function of sounding, stirring, like, as if it were a national anthem. And the air that he founded his composition on certainly had that quality. And I came up with the words that tried to sound enough like an anthemic text while still allowing a little bit of critique.
So I had to leave for my country above.
As the new millennium dawned, after almost 40 years with the group, Martin Fay retired.
I stuck it out and left there 2001 or something. Maybe a year or two before that I was toying with the idea anyway. Well, I was old enough to pick it up now. I must say I enjoyed every second of it.
For the first time, Paddy didn't replace a member of the Chieftains. The group continued as a five-piece and went back on the road, returning to Nashville for a gig with country and western superstars such as Ricky Skaggs and Emmy Lou Harris. Fun and games as usual. But it would be the last time Derek would play live.
In Nashville, the very last performance really of Derek's, he wasn't very well at the time.
His eyesight got very bad, and he had cataracts and whatever else.
And we actually got him into somebody to look, and they gave him back 20/20 vision, which he was so delighted with.
And he came back a new man. He was all excited and in great form for a while.
The doctors there said, I think you need a complete checkup and, you know, have a few things seen to. We all came home and he went into the Mayo Clinic in Scottsdale, Arizona.
You know, he got a clean bill of health. He was going home and he was sitting on the side of the bed, all packed and ready to go back to his cats, as he used to say, 7 cats. He was cat mad. Oh, it drove me mad.
Paddy rang saying he was worried that there was no word from Derek, and the hotel couldn't get into his room.
Just keeled over. The massive coronary.
He had apparently had his bag kind of on the bed and his airline ticket in his hand and had just slumped over and gone.
I left a message on his phone. Whether he ever got it or not, I don't know.
It was very sad because they didn't discover the body until 24 hours later.
It was horrible. That's very upsetting.
I always feel in going back to some of the same restaurants, because him and I used to get up to terrible things, and I haven't stopped talking about Derry. He hasn't gone away. He's still around. But I raise a glass and he's all right now.
My great gift's wheeling the harp case round airports. That's what I do best.
Will you please welcome the Chieftains?
Hello.
four of us left, and my intention not to recruit and take on any more chiefs. I mean, we certainly have our guests, and we've got lots of guests and young people too, which is the lovely Trina Marshall, one of the best harpers I've heard ever, and John Palatsky, who does this crazy style of dancing with his brother, the Ottawa Valley style of dancing, which is done nowhere else, only themselves. It's unique.
The Chieftains have always evolved, and today they continue with a new traditional musicians on stage with them. But there's one thing for certain. We haven't seen the end of this legendary group just yet.
Well, it's really all in Paddy's hands, I have to say, you know, because he has been the director of the band from day one.
The biggest reward of the whole thing is when the audience stand up at the end of the night. That's a drug. You get the biggest kick out of that imaginable.
It will continue, there's no question about that. But at, I hope, an acceptable level, if Paddy's listening.
I think it'll all fizzle out nicely. But as my wife, Rita, says, you know, well, he's in rehearsal for retirement, which, you know, we're cutting back on the tour next year. I'm only doing 4.5 weeks instead of 2 months or something. But I always say, I'll go down with the boots on. Once a chieftain, always a chieftain.
He's like a genie in a bottle, so wherever you've got him, you know, you're gonna rock. That's a fantastic ability.
I absolutely wholeheartedly applaud the Chieftains for going around the world and playing that music and working that hard.
They really put Irish music out there for people. I think they started this Irish craze.
They break the boundaries all the time, and they do work with people outside of the tradition. It's great honour to them.
It's been a fascinating and unique experience, I think, to hear how this group has developed out of the richness of traditional music.
It's music that comes from the bones to something that goes way, way, way back.
I have a very, very personal reason for loving the Chieftains is that they played at our wedding, and no finer way of starting a party.
I have no fears now that this folk music, this great folk art, is dying at all.